Hello, good morning po. Magpapalit lang po ako ng magsiswitch lang po ako ng I'm trying to switch my Facebook live streaming because I accidentally use Gray's account instead of my own account. Okay? So today I welcome you everyone. I welcome you. Today we will be discussing two important things. One is how to manage life during the crisis, okay? The coronavirus crisis. Second, I will also discuss how to utilize the G12 visions in a right way so that I could help you, no? Is the G12 vision will be working on our, you know? Some, that's the question. Will the G12 vision will work? Will this G12 vision will work during this crisis? Okay? So, I'm very sorry. I'm just trying to make an adjustment on my... Okay. I'm very sorry for that. Okay. But anyway, so again, I'd like to invite everybody, and I'd like to tell everyone that we are here now in the Philippines and sharing the word of hope to the whole world. So we welcome all those people from Latin America, from shortcut ko na lang ha, Latin America, in England or London, in Europe, in Dubai, in Asia, Thailand, Hong Kong, Singapore, you know, Vietnam, and Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. We welcome all the national leaders in the Philippines who are working hard to maintain the atmosphere of the churches, especially among the digital churches. But also, I'd like to welcome everyone who believe on Jesus Christ. No, we praise the Lord for our president who are working hard for our condition right now, and also we are also appreciate all the our Christian organization like the PCEC under the leadership of Bishop Noel Pantoja, the way director Bishop F. Tendero, no, the IFP, the PJM, Kuya Eddie Villanueva, Leo Alconga, we would like to really appreciate all your effort as you do it, okay, to share the compassionate heart of Jesus toward people. Do you know that most of the Christian organizations are working together? The Pilgrims is working hard, no? And I believe that so much people now are engaging, no, in helping. Now, I'd like to read a passage in the scripture, no? It says is that, for you were once in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. I'd like this passage to start with because the Lord remind us that we were once in darkness, but now we are transferred by God into the light. It means from ignorance, darkness means ignorance, from ignorance of God's law and God's principle, now we are beginning to see the light. We are beginning to see God's law and God's principle. You know, when I share about God's law and God's principle, it means if you do God's law and obey it, if you do God's principle, that's how life works. So Paul is telling us, do you know how your life will work even in the middle of crisis? He said, you cannot afford to live according to your ignorance. But you have to learn now how to live based on God's principle. Remember, I told you, the kingdom of God is never in crisis. Okay? There's no such thing as recession in the kingdom of God. That's why I'm so glad I am part of this kingdom of God, because the kingdom of God was not affected by this crisis. Because as long as the principle of God lives in your life, in your heart, you obey it, it will work. Life will always work once you follow the kingdom principle and the kingdom law. So that's why he said, live as children of light. You see that? He said that you have to live as people who now encounter God's law and God's principle. And then he said, this is how life it works. The fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. Do you know God's law and God's principle will constantly bring goodness, righteousness, and truth? Okay? So, Apostle Paul is giving us an idea that now, we are Christians. We used to be in the darkness. We used to be ignorant. Okay? Meaning to say, no understanding, no knowledge of God's law, and no knowledge of God's principle. But the moment you become a Christian, now you are in the light, the fruit of your life will become what? Righteousness or goodness. Meaning to say, you are doing good works. What is righteousness? Now you learn how to align to God's law and God's principle. And truth, meaning to say, the basis of our life. And then after that he said, and find out what pleases the Lord. So you know what pleases the Lord. You know how you please the Lord? You obey God's law and obey God's principle. When he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. When you seek first, how God works based on God's kingdom principle. That's the meaning of that. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Righteousness means you align, okay? You align with God's law and God's principle. And then you will find out what pleases the Lord. And he also said in verse 15 that be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise. Okay? Why do you become wise? Because I call it applied knowledge. Wisdom is applied knowledge. It never stops having our information, knowledge, you know, but it becomes what? It becomes wisdom. You know what is wisdom? Wisdom is the richest, is one of the riches of heaven. You know, wisdom means you know how to use the key of the kingdom to open and unlock something that is close to you. Okay? So, if you know the principle, God's law, you have the access, you have the keys of the kingdom. You become wise because you know how to open the door. You have the key, okay? If you have thousands of keys in your hands and you don't know how to use it, it's useless. But the kingdom of God, when you know the God's principle, then you can open the door. You can have the access. That's why making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Do you notice scientists, you know, doctors, they really find it hard to find solution because that's the limitation of man. There's always finite resources here on earth. You know, democratic government or whatever kind of government is incomparable to the government of God, the kingdom of God. So the kingdom of God is speaking to us now that you have to recognize now that the earth, here on earth, they don't have all the answer. They don't have all the solution. The solution is based on the one who created this earth, and that is the God of heaven, the King of the kingdom of God. He knows what to do. So I was saying last few days that it's time for the earth to rely from outside of the earth. And for me, that's the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. He can give us, sa totoo lang, He can give us solution and answer. That's why this is the time for us to make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. And then he said in verse 17, therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. You know why you become foolish? You insist that you don't know, even you don't know. Those are foolish people. So during this crisis, that is our basis for this morning. Okay, scripture, I'm here because me and you should never walk as unwise. Okay, but we have to be wise. And the basis of our wisdom is none other than understanding knowledge of God's law and principle. Okay? Now, I believe that the number one thing that the crisis is revealing is our character. Crisis reveals our character. Do you know that character is not made in crisis? It is only exhibited. So, this time, crisis is in our hands right now. But can we manage our crisis? That's a good question. So, this morning, I will be tackling the ways to manage our crisis. Do you know that now is the time to repent on trusting money? I will repeat that. Today, during this crisis, this is the time to repent from trusting money, or we constantly trust money. This is the time to align yourself with your God, who is your provider. Because this time, your money, I promise you, you will be shaken by that. Okay? So, your crisis situation will expose the foundation under your feet. That's the truth about this. This crisis will shake us. Every one of us will be shaken. Rich and poor, educated and non-educated, healthy and weak, pre or in bondage. Everyone will be shaken by this crisis to expose the foundation under our feet. And I believe that's why this crisis will be used by God to help us grow. During this crisis, God wants to get your attention. Because you always care about money. You care about your title. You always care about, you know, your pleasure, your leisure. You care about all those physical things. For you, physical matters is 99%. Only 1% are spiritual matters. And God is taking and getting your attention. Because God doesn't want to waste your life. I believe on that. Every one of us, God doesn't want us to waste our life. By the way, we have now 2,500 viewers in a matter of like 15 minutes now. Okay? So, I will repeat. This situation happens because God wants to get your attention, because God doesn't want you to waste your life. Okay? You know what God wants to teach you today? Whether you like it or not, He wants to give you a lesson in management skill. I will repeat that. He wants to give you a lesson in management skill. That's why my topic is how to manage your crisis. Because every one of us should learn management now. Okay? I want you to know that you're in this crisis. There will be financial implication. Take note on that. Some of you will lose your job. The unexpected bills are coming. There will be health crisis. Even when you are renting home right now, your landlord can suffer and it will affect you. What if your landlord was suffering from this crisis and you said, can you withhold my rental fee because I have no work? Then that's the fight. There will be trouble. Okay? Because your landlord is also affected. He needs a lot of money now. But you said, I don't have money because I no work, no pay. Well, I don't care. He will tell you that. You're using my facilities, you have to pay. That's crisis. Okay? There will be financial breakdown that affects the welfare of everyone. That's the truth. No? So, how can you begin to manage a crisis? That's a good question. So, let us discuss this a little bit. No? Because, you know, I know job problem. I told you, when there is a health crisis in a matter of few months, there will be an economic crisis. So what do you do now? Okay? Economic crisis is coming. Huh? Some of you will lose your job. Some of you will never even receive. No? I praise the Lord for our president. He releases $200 billion so that some of the people here, like the poor one, they get to receive. No? Wag lang, please don't be, ano, be patient, be patient. Darating din po yan. Do not be in a hurry that our president and the rest of his cabinet was trying to, you know, this is not the time to fight, to argue with one another. This is the time to complain, you know. Because the presidential leadership is not kingdom of God leadership. Ganun po yan. My mistake, I promise you, you will all see the limitations, you know, the shortcomings of our leaders. But be patient. Their leadership is not perfect leadership. The only effective, powerful leadership is the kingdom government of God. That's it. So if you try to compare the government of God and the Philippine government, that's... Oh no, you don't understand what is this reality. So some of you would like to share this. Presidential compared to our kingdom of God governance is totally different. Because the kingdom of God governance is composed of justice and righteousness, love and truth. Okay? It is composed of compassion for people. And sometimes, that's why I told you, when you elect your leaders, because they give you money, now you will suffer. Because I believe during the time of election, okay, now we are reaping the consequence. Because if we select leaders with competence, I called it a man of influence, like he is full of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, you know. He got an expertise, no? He got a heart for God. Kung yan ang binoto, if you vote those people, now you will harvest. But for those people, you know, usually the poor people are the one who are they are getting paid during elections. Now you suffer, okay? So don't blame anybody why you suffer now. Don't blame anybody. You deserve your leadership. You deserve your leaders. So let me go back. So once you are in the middle of crisis, remember the word, I have to manage this. Management, brother and sister. I have to manage this. So you have to manage. If you want to survive this crisis, I heard somebody told me, Pastor Oriel, the minimum is 3 months. Minimum is 3 months. And if it is mishandled by our president and the citizen. You see, this is not just a problem of the president. This is also a problem of the citizen, the Filipino citizen. No, our people in the land. That's why it's not working. When the stay at home, the commandment stay at home, they are fighting, they are, you know. That's why our president make a threat like to the rebels, and the NPA said, if you create on this order, okay, I will shoot you down. Well, that's according to the law. If you are trying to, you know, use illegal weapons and you're trying to create, you know, chaos by forcing your way, the government is in authority. It's telling us that the law is a punisher. It's a punisher. So if you insist to rebel, insist you to disobey the government, the government was designed by God to punish you. So, don't make a big issue out of what the president has stated, that I will shoot you down. He's talking about, not about the poor, but about the people who create chaos. The people who bring trouble, disorderliness in our nations. You will be shoot down. And I believe that that's part of the law. Okay? Of course, the government will just retaliate because you are violating the law. And if it is necessary, that's what the president, if it is necessary to fight back and to shoot you down, it will happen. Okay? So, I encourage everybody to learn how to manage crisis. So, let me give you an idea. Okay? How to manage and to begin to manage a crisis. No, I would like to encourage everybody. I want you to evaluate your life by doing these following things, okay? I will share. Because I believe that everybody need to be guided, particular here sa managing ng crisis. Now, let me evaluate. As we evaluate, let us ask by by discovering this truth, okay? During crisis, number one, you must know what you really need, not your want. You need to identify these two things, okay? Determine your needs, not your wants. Just like, for example, you need to make a list before you shop, or else you will spend all your money. Remember, your money is your best commodity right now. So don't ever go to shopping without listing, because or else you might get what you want, but you don't need it. That's the problem of many Filipinos. When they go to shop or groceries or mall, they don't list things. They just, you know, so whatever they want, they get it, but they don't need it. It's okay if you are rich, super rich, you can do that. But if you are poor, I encourage you. You have to know what is the difference between wants and needs. Okay? So, the first thing that you need to do is you must know what you really need, not your want. You know, find your distinction between needs and wants. That is the idea. Okay? We need to figure it out quickly, as soon as possible. Don't wait for another 3 months. Find out your needs, not your wants. Okay? And please, don't live according to people's expectations. Please. Because you will be in trouble. Okay? I would suggest that during crisis, your wants must go for the meantime. Okay? Let your needs remain in your heart and in your mindset. So, yan po yung una niyong gagawin. Okay? I will repeat. You must know what you really need, not your want. Number two, buy only the most important thing during crisis and delay your gratifications. Ito yung pangalawa. Okay? If you want to manage your crisis, know what you want and know what you need. Okay? Avoid your wants, focus on your needs. And then, you buy only the most important thing during crisis. If you can delay your gratification, it would be better. Okay? If you go to groceries, acquire only what you need, because you have to save a lot of money. In fact, in a crisis, as far as your acquisitions are concerned, I would encourage, just push the pause button. Pause. Missus, if you are shopping now with your husband, hold the hands, because you have the push button. He was trying to buy everything, just push the pause button and your wife will stop. There must be a pause button. During crisis, pause muna tayo sa mga hindi dapat bilhin. Okay? Wala mo nang mamimili. Please, use the pause button. Don't buy all you want. Okay? Buy only that is significant and important. Now, as you know, we have a problem of our income today. Some of you were not able to get your salary. Now, what is 8,000 when the government give you that? Okay? What is 8,000? You tell me. Well, for poor people, that is a lot of money. But if they don't know how to spend it, it becomes zero. Okay? Your income should never be ahead of your spending should never be ahead with your income. I think it's a good question, that is your income ahead over your spending, or your spending is ahead of your income? Of course, spending and income should be balanced. If your income is like right now during crisis, how much is your income? Now, how much is your spending? You have to look into that, because that is so important. Okay? Now, I want to warn all those people who are using credit card too much. Be careful to use that. Okay? Today, you better lose your pride than to lose your heart. Okay? So, yan po yung pangalawa. Number three, do not live beyond your means or ability to pay your bills. Save as much as you can. Mga kapatid, you know, during crisis, you have to change your attitude, especially your buying ability, because it depends on your means. If your means is only 5,000, please do not spend 20,000 because you have credit cards. Okay? Do not live beyond your means or your ability to pay your bills. I would suggest save as much as you can during this crisis. Okay? Number 4, I hope you're learning. Very simple lang po ito. Withdraw the unnecessary. Meaning to say, do not do anything, do not make any decision that is unnecessary. Okay? When you have determined the difference between your needs and your wants or your extras, you can draw the line between the necessary and the unnecessary. Yan po yun. B, when, in fact, when I said, when in time of crisis, please do not act as if you are wiser than God. Get back to God's principle and God's law. Because God's law and God's principle gives you, the truth is, it gives you the way how life works. So do not behave like you are, you know, better than God. Okay? Stop super spiritual yung life mo. No? You spend so bad and then you say, God will provide for everything, please. It doesn't work that way. Okay? If you can revise your spending habits, you might have a lot of surplus. I would suggest that. I-revise mo lang yung spending habits mo. Why I want you to revise your spending habits? Because at most, we also want to help other people. You know, we want to help other people. It is my heart to help other people. So, let us not, by the way, I just to remind you, when you are helping people, may challenge nga ako eh. Huwag yun i-post, huwag yun i-Facebook. Of course, iba naman po yun. You know, it's different when you are promoting your ministry so that other people can support you. You can post that, no? I know some of the pastors are spending a lot of money, you know, convincing other people to support their ministry. Well, that's okay for me. But, you know, don't be like those politicians. Every time they help, they have to post it and picture it. Because, again, politicians always prepare for the next election. Then let us forget that, okay? But we Christians, no? We Christians, when we try to help other people, please, tone down. Let's tone down it, okay? Let us not brag about it, you know? Let us not get the glory. So please don't do that. I know some of you are helping other people. I really appreciate that. I love it, okay? And please, if it is possible, let us help other people where God can take the glory. Okay? That's why if you can keep on spending money for yourself. You know, I'm afraid that you cannot give time and effort to help other people. Because my goal, that's why I want you to manage your resources so that you can help other people. Because that's why I need to say no to so many things right now. Okay, and I encourage you, if you have friends who are so negative, please withdraw yourself from them. Okay, it cannot help. Okay, number 5 is delay your major projects. I would really encourage you. You know, everyone before the lockdown, before the coronavirus, we have to plan to build our house, we have to plan to buy our cars, we have to buy this and buy and buy and buy this. I encourage you, delay your major projects. While you should remain busy and work hard, you should not undertake big project right now or new project in the middle of crisis. Delay nyo muna. No? If you are trying to build a house, ano muna, you have to delay because it is very important. Okay? Very important po yan. You know, when you delay your projects, your money will be... Anything can happen, you don't know. That's why stop mo muna lahat yung mga project mo ngayon. You really need to stop it or delay, at least delay. So that when you want to do this and do that, buy this and buy that, delay mo muna because you need a lot of liquid, okay? I mean cash. So that when you are in the middle of that crisis, anything, any moment, you can do, okay? Now, number 6, value your possessions. Praise God. Now, if you have a house, you have cars, you have to value that. Maintain it, okay? Your house must be maintained at least this 30 days lockdown. At least you can clean your house. Maintain mo. By maintaining it, you show that you value your possessions. Yung mga, your cars, your motorcycles, clean it, condition it. You need to value your possessions. Okay? Your savings account, you have to value that. That's how to manage your resources. Because I'm saying this because I realize that during crisis, money is so important. Okay? I know we have to pray, but we have to pay. I believe we have to pray, but we have to pay. So you can always pay because wala yung monetary value naman yan, di ba? But when you buy for your food, when you buy for, you know, medical needs, that's money. So please, do understand, okay? Huwag natin i-over-spiritual everything, okay? You need to, number 7, you need to save, you need to conserve, and protect your resources. Yan po yung number 7, okay? During crisis, you need a structure and you need a plan. Okay, you need to find out how can I structure these things in my resources, in pera ko, yung matitira pa. You need a plan. You need a plan. Plan, plan, plan. Magplano po talaga kayo. Is your money can last for the next 3 months or only for 2 weeks? You need to plan. Okay? Can you manage 6 months without work? You lose your job for the next 6 months. Can you manage? Can your family still eat? Okay? Can you still pay the bills, electric bill, water bills? Well, praise God. The government said it's going to delay payment for all the electric bills. You know, that's good. I'm so glad that the president do that for us. Okay, but remember this. What if it is 3 months and 6 months? So you have to plan. Okay? That's what I'm talking about, management. Okay? At this time, you need to be really decisive rather than impulsive about what you do about your money. Listen to this. Just for today, unemployment is down. Think about it. And, you know, more people will discover that they should have been saving for the rainy days. I'm happy I was able to survive now because I saved money. I saved. And because when I save it, wow, now I can say, God, thank you, Jesus. Because during this crisis, I was able to prepare myself. So what if you are unemployed after 3 weeks or 3 months, and then you have no savings? That's a big problem. How can you manage that? That's why today some of the people said, oh, I should save for the rainy days. But sometimes it's too late now. Wala ka na saving. Okay? We need to develop a new habits of taking care of what we have already have, our money. Learn how to take care of it. Our possession, our great resources. You need to learn how to use things that you already have. Okay? Kailangan niyo po yan. No? I was reading a book about the early Puritans when they settled in America. They have an idea, they have mindset and thinking that they have to use everything. And we have to fix whatever got broken, and we have to reuse things after they were no longer useful for their original purpose. May reuse sila, no? Whatever is broken, fix it lang muna. Huwag bibili ng bago. That's how they do it. That's the early Puritans. Okay? If you are short of money right now, no? I would suggest you don't need lottery. You need management. Anybody have financial difficulties right now, automatically get into management. Okay? You need to learn to steward your God-given resources. You need to use your wisdom and understanding. Okay? You need to save, conserve, and protect the provision that God has given you. Okay? So, I believe yan pong pito na yan, that 7 things can help you to manage your crisis. Lalo, especially to those people who lack money. Okay? And the love of money, the lack of money, that 2 words is very important. Some people love money, other people lack money. Okay? But it will always lead to trouble. So, the key word is management. So, I like to popularize the word during crisis. The key is managing my life, managing my resources. Okay? Of course, for you, pastor, and leaders, the key is managing your ministry. Remember, you're a kingdom citizen, and during the crisis, God wants you to trust Him. You do not have to be anxious about anything. Do not be anxious about saving so many things. Just trust God. Okay? You do not have to worry about anything. You just need to manage God-given resources. Take care of it, and I promise you, He will help you. Okay? So that's the first part of my teaching this morning. I call it crisis management. Now, do you know that? Let's go back. Let's go now. Training in our church ministry. So the primary 12, the pastors, and the leaders are now listening now. Okay, we will go now to leadership training. This is now mentoring churches because this is very important. Okay, I'd like to mention some questions. Na, you know, when I look at my notes, okay? This is the time for all the pastors to create the new normal, okay? This is now our challenge, no? To create the new normal. Now, let me ask first question. Alam niyo po, almost how many days has been gone because of this quarantine? Now, I want you to listen very carefully. Last week, I talked about innovations because I saw it. Pastors who insist to do their old traditions, you will not last long. So I'd like to call upon the attention of every digital pastor to listen to me. Another pastor who not even doing G12, it's time to innovate. And you yourself will be the one to create a normal ministry. The new normal in your ministry. You will be the one to create it. Okay? What if I ask this question? What is your plan? Now there is a lockdown. How do you operate your ministry? Now there is a lockdown. There are imposed limitations to us. Immediately, you don't know what to do. Okay? How can you manage your existing ministry during crisis? Tell me. How can you do that? Huh? How can you do that? Can Peace of Prayer, can we still use the G12 strategy and the process? Okay? So think about it. You think about it. Okay? That's why I have to share something here. No? I have to share something here. Are you, pastor, still connected to our church members during this crisis? Can you still connect? That's a good question. Okay? Some of you, we are lost in our ways that the strategy is no longer workable. Because you are trying to use the old ways of doing things. But we are now in crisis. How do you use your G12 strategy? Is it workable? Of course, yes. I can testify that it is still workable. Okay? Some of you are overwhelmed because not every pastor have technical knowledge. Huh? You know, I'd like to share this. Not because you have Facebook account, you're doing it effectively. Not because you have live streaming once every day or probably once or twice a week, you're doing it right. You know why? Let me give you an example. There are many pastors today that are using the live stream with only 2 viewers. Why is it 2 viewers? You see, because you don't know how to do it. The only thing you know is to push the button and make a live streaming. Do you know what I did before I come up with almost 3,000 viewers every time 3,000, 10,000 views? Because I do something, I know how to use my technology. Okay? So that's why I want to teach you. Pastors, have you noticed? Are you aware that there are only 3 people watching your live streaming? Because you don't know, and you don't know how to do it, you can have like 500 viewers or 1,000 viewers if you do it right. Okay? If you do it right. If you do it right. So, let me share that to you so that we can maximize. Okay? Now, listen. Listen very carefully. Today, I'd like to encourage you what to do in our ministry, what to do in our G12 vision. Okay? I want you to write down number one. Okay? Capitalize your knowledge on technology. All the technology that was created will become useful for us. Because Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, okay, live streaming, Zoom is the only way to connect to people. So don't tell me I don't know how to use technology. Then your ministry will die. I'll give you wisdom, okay? If you're a pastor and you don't know how to use live streaming, well, I'm sure there are one or two young people who knows it how to do it. What you need to do is to invite them to your house and try to ask them, help me to have a live stream so that I could connect to my people. Now, that's the first problem. The pastor, I encourage you to use your technology, okay? But you need to know how to use it. If you don't know how to do it, invite one or two young people with you and they will help you, I promise you. Second, inform your whole congregation, okay, that you are using a live streaming way of ministry. Think about this. You have 100 people. Before the lockdown, you have 100 people. Now you want to live stream. Are you watching your live stream? Your 100 people, the people are only watching 7, 5. Meaning to say, you are not aware if there are someone listening to you or not. Today, I got almost 3,000 viewers before I end. Okay? So I encourage everybody, pastors, don't just have live stream. You must have viewers. You must have viewers. How do you have viewers? Okay. That's why if you are a G12 pastor, you are in advantage. Because you just call and connect to your primary 12 and your primary 12 will rally all your members, the whole family to watch you. Because if you are live streaming and only two people is watching, you are wasting your time. That's not the purpose of live streaming. Remember, this is the new normal now. Okay? Remember, the goal of your technology is to bring your inspirational message and to bring your instructional message. That's the goal. I'm doing live streaming to give inspiration, encouragement, and motivation to people plus instruction. So, you work hard, you plan your teaching, and then only two people only is watching you. What's the use? Okay? Of course, you will tell me, Pastor, at least two people is watching me. No. You maximize your work, your ministry. You strategize. So, my strategy is just to, I got a lot of connections with my, you know, primary 12. I send them a message, oh, get ready. On next Saturday, I will be doing this, and this is the topic. And then I told them early this morning, I sent them a rally of people so that they could listen to us. Remember, what's the use of live streaming and nobody's watching? So you see, you can use your technology but useless. But I want you to use your technology but useful. So that's what I encourage you. So it's a preconditioning of your church. Connecting, tell your church, okay, this is the new norms now. Okay, this is now how we do ministry during crisis. Now, listen very carefully. I want you to hear this word. It doesn't sink in so far. With so much members, it doesn't sink. It should sink in their mind, in their hearts, that this is the new norms. This is the new normal now. So you don't go to a building because the church is not a building. Church are people. So the church is gathering through this application like Zoom, FaceTime, like this, live streaming. This is the new norms now. We are the church. We are people. So please, that's the number one thing that you need to do, using your technology, but technology that has been what? People are accommodating it and people are watching it. People are, they are excited to become part of it. So this is the first thing that you need to utilize during this crisis. Use your technology. When you have technology, you have a team. You need to have a team. Team that promotes, team that mobilizes. Listen to this. Imagine you have, I've been watching Facebook live streaming. Do you know that probably I'm just do it by myself. But behind the hidden system, remember, I mobilize my people first before I conduct this. Now, most pastor, they think it's magic since they have live streaming. Buti na lang kung artista ka, lahat manonood dyan. Kung hindi ka naman kilala. See, when you are not popular, at least you are popular in your church and during live streaming. That's the best thing. Okay? Forget about being popular all around the world. Just become popular with your church so that the church would feel that you love them and you want to minister to them. Okay? So the key word in technology, without mobilization is useless. So you need to learn how to mobilize your people. Mobilize them if you want to give them the message for life class. Mobilize them for prayers. Mobilize. You keep on mobilizing because when you use your technology and you don't have mobilization skill, your technology will be useless because only one people is watching you. You observe. Watch all those videos, live streaming by pastors because they don't know how to mobilize 2, 3, 4 men. Sometimes 10 people is watching them. But the truth is, thousands of people can watch them if they know how to mobilize their people. Now, the ratio is this. If you have 100 members, at least 90 or 80 to 90% is watching you during the live stream because you are good on mobilization. I'm not that good yet, but I'm still working on it. Okay? So, now, of course, most people are not able to watch because this is the next problem now. Walang load, no loads, no internet access. Then I'd like to encourage someone need to learn how to download it. Okay, download it. And then disseminate it to your people. At least there's a little bit delay. Okay, my church, although I do live streaming, not my whole church is watching me, but there is a delay. Telecast, repeat. Okay, we repeat it, and then we have so much watch party so that the whole congregation can watch it. So please, I really encourage you. Now, another thing is this. Your leadership should be constantly connected to you either by text, by calls, or by video conference. Your problem is this. When you have a poor church, your people said, I have no load. Now that's the time to be merciful and gracious. I allotted budget for all my poor leaders who can't afford. I even give them, I get their numbers and I pass a load so that the pass a load can reach them. Now we can text, unlimited text, unlimited calls plus sana, and then plus we could also have we can download materials, we can download a video conference so that all my leaders can receive motivation, inspiration and instruction. Remember this, we use technology not to become popular, we use technology to reach our people so that we could inspire, motivate them, and give them instruction during the crisis. That's our purpose. So that is using technology. Okay? Now, another is the cell group system. This is the second. How to do the G12 system, the cell system. Well, that's the only way at what I call point of contact. Remember, communication is the commodity during crisis. You don't see them physically. you don't meet them physically, but at least we can communicate to them. So I'd like to encourage everybody, this is the next thing that you need to know. Not just utilizing your technology. Now, we have to maximize the cell group system of our churches. First, I'd like to encourage every pastor, your team of 12 must be able to receive a lot of instruction from us as pastors. They need to receive a lot of motivations and inspiration. Once they are inspired, motivated, and instructed, they can effectively minister to their cell group. Now, do not expect that your people can minister to their cells if they are not motivated, not inspired, and not instructed. So regularly, you have to meet. Anyway, we don't have that much. We don't have that much, you know, time for anything. The only, you know, you have so much time to minister to your people if you are a pastor in primary church. So cell group system is one of the most effective. One leader can take care of 12 people. Okay? One leader can take care of more people. So technology plus cell system and the pastor and the primary church, the team. Like you, I want you to hear this, no? The G12 team and its pastors, the technology and the cell system, this is the three important group of people or three part of our new normal. You have to learn to use cell system, the G12 team, and your technology. Okay, these three. Every churches, every pastors, utilize your cell system, your G12 team, and your technology. These three things will help you to mobilize your people. Because if you cannot mobilize, then all these people will become immobilized. Okay? Remember, during crisis, this is now our opportunity. Do you know that many backsliders want to go back to God? Do you know those people who don't listen to our gospel, now they are willing to listen? And your problem is, what if your people are immobilized because they lack communication, they lack motivation, they were not inspired by your leadership? That's why it is important for every pastors that while we are in the G12 or we are in the middle of crisis, the G12 strategy must be operational. Okay? So, again, I will be using technology, I will be using cell group, I will be using the G12 team. These three, again, is for the purpose of mobilizations. Okay? Now, of course, we have also to discuss what do we do with our Life Plus and School of Leaders, what do we do with our PID. Well, we can do that. Okay? So now, I want you to see these things. The next thing is your ministry innovations. Understand this truth. We have no choice but to innovate. Okay? Like for example, okay, how do you meet your leadership team, your G12 team? So you used to be in the church or probably in a certain house, but now it's different. It's now on Zoom. That's innovations, right? Now if you want to minister, motivate, inspire, instruct, now the avenue, it used to be on the classroom or it should be in a meeting room, but now innovation is now on the live streaming, okay? Now, listen to this. I want you to know how to apply the G12 strategy in the middle of this coronavirus crisis. Okay, let me start. What is the strategy of G12? Win, consolidate, disciple, send. So how do we win during G12 crisis, during coronavirus crisis? You know how do we win? We win, if I'm a pastor, I want you to have this. Come up with a day, okay, when you are about to have a live stream for evangelistic message. And your expected audience is your whole membership with their family. Don't do it every day. Please don't do it. Just do it once a week so that walang di magsasawa mga tao. Once a week. Focus on evangelistic meeting. Find the needs and meet the needs. Share about the crisis going on and how can they trust God. That's the kind of message that you need to preach. Okay? Now listen. mobilize your 12. That's how to do it. If you want to evangelize, mobilize the 12 and utilize all your cell leaders to mobilize them, prepare on the certain date, like Friday in the afternoon. Okay? What time? At least 3 or 4 o'clock. Because finish nang maglab, maluto, magluluto pa mamaya. So, in the middle of like 2 or 3 in the afternoon, gather all your members. But, most of your members, their family members, are not yet saved. Since, these are captive audience, they don't know what to do. They have nothing to do. So, if you tell them, okay, hey, I encourage you to watch this message. My pastor is preaching about this crisis. Let's hear from him. That's how we win. And then once we are able to win, you need to have communications if the family is responding positively. Because there should be a plan, like you plan to evangelize, but there's a plan to consolidate. Okay? So let's plan like this Wednesday, this like I said, Friday will be your evangelistic message, but the next day you will be your consolidation message. So those people who responded positively to your evangelistic soul-winning live streaming, the next day you need to consolidate them. Wow, that's a new innovation, right? Who is your target? The family of your members. We pray that the whole, you know, I expect this. If I will be doing this next week, I will be doing that. No? If I will be doing that next week, I expect after this lockdown, thousands of people will come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because we strategize and we plan and we manage our visions. So don't tell me that you become useless during this time. No, you can become fruitful and you can bring a lot of souls to Jesus Christ. Utilize live streaming, bring it to their houses, their families, preach the gospel, bang, and when they receive Christ, anybody who receives Christ, send the message to their cell leaders bring their message to 144 leaders, 144 bring this message to the primary 12 so that they could at least count how many people come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, and the next day, we have consolidation messages. That's how we win souls and make disciples. So, that's how we win. Now, or on the other end, you could also invite your relatives inside the house. You know? Remember, when you are already in the house, you are no longer, you are able to, watch together, okay? But at least never invite other people from the outside or else you may be contaminated. Just for family use only, okay? So, do you believe that this coronavirus problem can be a great opportunity to evangelize your family? Because most of your family members are now desperate. They don't know what to do. They want to know something. So I really encourage you, prepare your church to have an evangelistic live streaming. And when you have evangelistic live streaming, don't do that until you mobilize the whole church. Okay? I don't want you to preach evangelistic message for the outside people. But I want you to preach to all those men. You see, I'm not talking to the whole world now. I'm just talking to all G12 pastors. Because I know you need a lot of inspiration, motivation. And that's why, please, utilize. We can evangelize our family. Okay? We have another like 2 weeks or 4 weeks pa. Consolidated na yan, mga kapatid. I believe we can go. So, again, we evangelize our families using live streaming videos, and after that we have a plan to consolidate them so we could ask these people for like 10 to 15 minutes of consolidation. The consolidation can be done by the cell leaders, by the 144 or the 12. Okay, the pastor must preach the gospel, but the team of 12 must be mobilized to evangelize. So I hope you learned something how we do evangelize. Okay, so another thing is, how do we do school of leaders and how do we do live class training? Well, we could also do live class training, live streaming. The same principle, first mobilize first the new believers, then go to the plan 40 plan and prayers. You see, the strategy is the same, but it happens through multimedia. Okay? It happens through our live streaming. So, you can still have live class, school of leaders, by using all the necessary technology. Remember this, if once we are in the middle of crisis, let not the crisis stop us from doing and running the visions. Okay, now, ministry on innovation is necessary. Do you know that the key here is your primary 12? Because your primary 12 will be utilized to mobilize the people. They are, no, that's why I told you, those who are doing the digital vision, you are blessed because you have now the structure. You now have, if you listen to me for the last 3 years and you're able to structure your church with your 12, I promise you, you are now reaping the harvest. Now you have a team that can mobilize the whole people in your church to bring and run the vision effectively. Mapalad yung mga nag-digital na yun. Kasi meron kayong team. You have a team. And your team, when they were inspired and motivated, and they will be given instruction. One thing about I like digital people, when they're given instruction, they do it. That's why I expect that after this crisis, thousands of G12 churches will grow because you are constantly inspired and motivated and you are constantly given directions and instruction. So, okay, the last thing that I want to share with you is planning and management. G12 cannot be effective without good planning and managing the visions. So let me close by telling you that our G12 study during crisis can happen. Okay? I love the cell system. Thank God for the technology. Well, I have a new mindset. I need to do ministry innovation. I need to utilize my team, G12. But I need to have plan and I need to manage it. Okay? So, again, my brother and sister, we will stop here for a while. Win souls and make disciples. This crisis, I pray that every families of every G12 members can win your whole family, can consolidate your whole family. G12 leaders, please, help your pastors to mobilize all the church. Para sa akin, all your church members must have time to listen and hear inspiration and instruction from your pastor. Pastor, again, let us use live streaming, okay, Zoom applications so that we keep on connecting to our people. That's the only way. So today, we have just finished how to manage your crisis and how to run the visions in the middle of this crisis. I believe G12 is still working and I believe thousands of souls will be saved because that's the bottom line. Whatever study that if you are doing live stream, nobody got saved. You're not using it right. Okay, if you're using live streaming with nobody's watching you, you're not using it right. Again, the keyword is planning, okay, management and mobilization. I will repeat: planning, management and mobilization. These three words are so important for every pastor who wants to become effective. So today, I encourage everybody, keep on working, keep on doing the vision, never give up, never surrender. Remember this, God is with us. God will never leave us, and His promise is sure. The kingdom of God is never in crisis. The kingdom of God is in control. I'm glad that I'm ambassador of that kingdom, and I'm glad I am the citizen of that kingdom. Every one of you are with me, knowing and believing. Malalagpasan din natin to. Amen. At paglagpas natin, we become better leaders, better pastors, and better citizens of God's kingdom. God bless you. May you continually serve the Lord for the glory of His name. Father, I praise you and I thank you for this day where we could learn from your word that we need to be wise and we could make the most of every opportunity because these days are evils, Lord. Lord, today I pray that as you grant us the wisdom, knowledge, and understanding to know what to do in the middle of crisis. Lord, thank you so much for your love. Thank you so much for your guidance. Thank you for every opportunity that you are teaching us, Lord. Thank you for making us wise, Lord. because it's time, Lord, to connect again to our to your people and to minister to them. Lord, I pray for every pastor and leaders. Give them knowledge and wisdom. Give them strength and power. Give them anointing, Lord. Give them your word to them so that as they go and touch your people, they will be encouraged and motivated, Lord. They will be inspired and they will know what to do. They will be instructed. So thank you, Lord. Be with us and we thank you. And we pray this in Jesus' name.